Intrigue, conspiracy, paranoia. This is a spy story that's been played out in downtown Auckland. A former KGB man arrives in town on a forged passport. Next, the spy himself is being watched. Spy versus spy. Fanciful? It would seem not. On Friday, the police were seeking assurances from us here at TVNZ that Sunday would not compromise their operatives in the field. That's how touchy this story is. Janet McIntyre investigates.
Were you a spy?
Yes, I was.
Are you still a spy?
No, not anymore. Not at least 9 years. No, in active service. Former spy, ex.
Who is this man who calls himself Boris Karpichkov? And why in the streets of downtown Auckland is he being watched?
I think there may be people following you now, but certainly not to my knowledge. And I'm not involved in it, and I don't know what they're doing or who they are.
Boris Karpichkov tapes the phone calls made to him by police. He likes to keep records.
If other people who are not policemen are following you around, then maybe you are right. Maybe it is the SIS.
I consider it as harassment. I consider it as some sort of bullying. I consider it as some sort of persecution for nothing. I did nothing illegal in here.
State surveillance in New Zealand? If so, who's the target? He claims he's ex-KGB, the former Soviet Union's feared security service.
Of course, these documents you could easily have forged.
No, only state can forge such quality of documents.
Like the fake passports he says he was issued by the Latvian security service to infiltrate the CIA.
Estonian passport.
Did you ever live in Estonia?
Never.
How he got into New Zealand last year is a story in itself. We'll come to that in a moment. Boris now fears if he's sent back to his native Latvia, he'll be killed for exposing corruption before and after the Cold War ended.
I would be killed, I would be dead very soon. Not only in Latvia, even in Russia, all former Soviet Union.
In a plot straight out of a Le Carre novel, Boris Karpichkov, ex-Soviet spy, says he came to New Zealand seeking a haven, a safe place for himself and his family. Instead, he says he's been hounded, harassed, even physically assaulted by New Zealand police or secret services. Sounds too cuckoo to be true? Maybe it is, maybe it isn't.
You can consider me insane, you can consider me obsessed of some paranoid ideas, but it is an established fact, and it could be proven easily.
In the cold, dark days of the USSR, Boris Karpichkov was raised in Riga, Latvia, to be what he calls a block-headed communist.
I was a typical product of Soviet system. So I thought that communism is a bright future for everyone in the entire world. Obviously, completely brainwashed.
Invited to join the KGB when he was 18, the qualified mechanical engineer later worked for the secret service that replaced it, the FSB, and for others.
I worked for Russian security services. Later I worked for Latvian security services, American security services, French security services. I became the Russian spook.
A man of many faces who lived and worked in the shadows. Inevitably, he became embroiled in betrayals, conspiracies, allegations of state corruption. He was accused of embezzling funds from a bank. Facing death threats, he fled with his family to London. And after 9 years seeking asylum there, without success, the former KGB spy turned up at Auckland International Airport.
Can I see that passport that you entered New Zealand with?
Yes, with a Lithuanian passport.
Have you ever lived in Lithuania?
I had no any connections with Lithuania at all, no any relatives, no any citizenship of Lithuania.
So you got into New Zealand on a forged passport?
Yes, I did.
How did you get this passport then?
So I bought this passport in London.
For how much?
2,200 British pounds. And I had to earn money, I had to go to building site.
And here we have a picture of you?
Yes, it's my picture.
And is that your name?
Not my name. I have no idea who this person is.
Did you have any trouble at all coming into Auckland Airport with your passport, your forged passport?
Not at all.
Walked straight in?
Walked straight in, no question asked.
Were you surprised at how easy it was to get into New Zealand?
In New Zealand, I was amazed, actually, because it looked like kick your feet the door and it's opened.
12 days after his arrival, he surrendered his passport to immigration and declared it fake. In a 135-page statement about his life and his fears for his life, he explains how he procured it from a Russian crook, then used it to get into New Zealand. He tendered the documents to immigration in his bid for refugee status. Immigration returned the forged but apparently still valid passport 2 months later, stamped with a work permit.
It means that New Zealand authorities gave me the right to use this passport.
Knowing full well it's forged?
Yes, we're obviously absolutely well aware about all these facts.
In documents filed with the Refugee Status Branch of New Zealand Immigration, it's acknowledged they've received a photocopy of Mr. Karpichkov's false passport. As his application for refugee status dragged on, Boris says he became unwell, some mystery illness doctors have been unable to explain. He rapidly lost 20 kilograms. He's on strong painkillers. Sunday has seen his medical records.
Before I was a healthy guy. Now you can see I'm almost just corpse who barely can talk. So I consider myself walking corpse.
What have doctors been able to tell you about what's causing these problems?
They told me it is great mystery.
As unlikely as it sounds, he thinks he may have been poisoned here, not by New Zealanders, but by agents working for Russia.
Sometimes I'm having pain which is insufferable.
Just like his former KGB colleague, Alexander Litvinenko, who was poisoned in London and died.
Do you believe you're going to die of this?
I cannot exclude such things.
Paranoid? Delusional? But what if they really are watching you here in New Zealand? And what happens when a spy confronts another spy?
He shouted, I will smash your phone on your head.
The story takes us in dramatic new directions after the break. Latvian-born Boris Karpichkov, 48, seeking refuge in New Zealand, believes he's under surveillance by our security services.
How do you know?
I'm professional, I was trained. I myself, as a counterintelligence officer, participated in such operations, surveillance operations. I know how these people operate, I know how surveillance teams work, I know how they think, I know how to organize such operations, surveillance operations, if I was such officer of such unit.
It's intriguing. Claims of being watched and being followed by surveillance cars in downtown Auckland. The same cars again and again.
Why are they following you, if they are?
I have no a single clue.
You've obviously had connections with organized crime in the past.
Perhaps you do pose a threat here.
I'm not a person who poses threat to any country, including New Zealand. And putting me under such strict surveillance, it is absolutely groundless.
He records details. Cars, colors, number plates, times and dates. In the second week of July this year, he says teams of cars are closely surveilling him around his apartment block in Anzac Ave and everywhere he walks. It's about to get ugly. On July the 11th, he approaches the driver of a blue Mazda parked in Short Street, 70 meters from his front door.
Very politely try to tell him that to pass my best regards to his superiors from and to tell him that enough is enough. I took his picture on my mobile camera. Guy jumped out from his car, approached me from behind, from my back. He was shouting, he was screaming. He started to kick me, punch me. He attacked me second time. Again started to kick me and to punch me into my chest. And at that time he shouted, I will smash your f***ing phone on your f***ing head. It was exactly his words.
Boris immediately complains to police and, meticulous as ever, photographs his injuries. He believes his assailant is from New Zealand's secret service, the SIS. But he says he hears nothing from the police for 2 months, just as Boris approaches the media.
I received phone call from a so-called investigator from the police, namely Mark Williams.
Who is it?
Detective Sergeant Mark Williams, Boris.
Curiously, from the Diplomatic Protection Squad. As usual, Boris records everything.
He called me and tried to play everything down, my complaint down. He tried to tell me that it wasn't New Zealand Secret Service. I told him I didn't expect that New Zealand Secret Service had ever admitted that it was.
He is not with the SIS, but he was with a surveillance group. He was part of a surveillance group. And I can put it in writing to you too, that you were not the target.
But excuse me, how it could be if the same cars, the same number plates, the same guys appeared exactly in the places where I went?
And among those following him, according to Boris, was this man, the man who attacked him. Who is he?
And all I can tell you is that the person who confronted you was a policeman. And he has admitted as much. He has made a statement saying that, yes, he did. He's sorry. He lost his temper. And he apologises. And he is very sorry for what happened because he was unprofessional and he lost his temper.
Detective Sergeant Williams then tries to discourage Boris from taking the matter further.
I have spoken to the driver who is prepared to give you a written apology for what has happened, and that will be the end of it.
I told him, if written apologies would be given to me, I would. I have only one condition. I would like that these written apologies would be delivered to me in personal by person who attacked me, and because I got reasons. Because I just want to look at his eyes.
But that's not what happened. Detective Williams, not the attacker, called a meeting with Boris and produced this extraordinary so-called written apology. There's no letterhead, and it's written as if Boris is the author, but he's not. Detective Williams read the letter down the phone to Boris, who, of course, was recording.
Hi, Boris. Kapshkov made a complaint of assault against the driver of a blue Mazda motor vehicle. I have been informed that the driver has been located and interviewed. I have been told that he has admitted being physically aggressive towards me and has apologised for his behaviour. I am happy for this matter to be dealt with by way of conciliation. It means that it will be dealt with by the police and the man will be disciplined within the police. Do you understand that?
Yes.
Are you happy with that result?
Yes, I don't care.
The letter is witnessed by Detective Sergeant M. Williams. Police confirmed to us he is a member of the protection squad.
Boris thought that would be the end of it. The weeks of what he was sure was constant surveillance. But he says it was not. There's a lull, then the cars are back. Either he's paranoid or this is getting really strange.
This is one of the surveillance cars which followed me all over this morning. Now it is about 10 o'clock in the morning.
And a few days after Boris first contacts us at Sunday, he arrives on time for a meeting at TVNZ.
Interesting thing is that they are spying on me even when I approach National TV. Car is parked nearby of the New Zealand TV station. One of the watchers inside the car.
I even managed to capture this guy's sitting in car, his face.
So that's just outside the entrance of TVNZ?
Yes.
So you said you saw that car a few days ago as well?
I saw this car following me yesterday, all over the day, in the area nearby of my residence place.
So where would you say this car would be right now? Any idea?
I think this car will not appear today because the guy saw that he was exposed.
So just tell me, how long has he been there?
I stayed about 15 minutes and was walking around TVNZ 15 minutes. He was stayed there. When you appeared, he disappeared.
We followed up on Boris's data, searching through public records. We checked the number plates of vehicles Boris says have had him under surveillance since July.
Call it coincidence, but a lot of the cars have a lot of things in common. There are 19 cars registered to people whose names are not on the electoral roll and not in any phone book, and whose physical addresses just don't exist.
One car's owner is supposed to live at 44 Sefton Ave Grey Lynn, but number 42 is the last house in the street. 104 Eastdale Road, Avondale, same story. After 100, it's a dead end. 56 Benders Avenue, Glenfield. 15 Steed Road, Waitakere. 21 Hunter Terrace, Christchurch. Same story wherever we looked. Cars with addresses and owners that don't seem to exist.
But the owners do have post office boxes. And here's another interesting thing. 7 cars are registered to people who share a box in North Harbour. Another 10 people share a box in Wellington. And 2 more share a box in Hamilton East. Who owns the boxes? That we don't know. But what an odd set of coincidences.
Something else we discover. This car, filmed by Boris when he came to TVNZ 3 weeks ago, has the same postal address in North Harbour as the car of the man who assaulted Boris in the street in July. So who are the mystery drivers of 19 cars that Boris says have made themselves glaringly obvious to him?
I am not a spy. I am not with the New Zealand SIS. So if other people who are not policemen are following you around, then maybe you are right. Maybe it is the SIS.
In your professional opinion, how would you say they're operating here?
These people are amateurs. We acting in absolutely improper and foolish way, and sometimes we even cannot understand that we have been exposed.
All the while, Boris was being watched by police, the SIS, who knows who. He was fighting the fight to stay in New Zealand. He lost. The Refugee Status Branch declined him residence on the grounds of his historical links with organised crime in Russia and Latvia. Grounds rejected by Boris.
I'm nobody. I'm just ordinary old chap, ordinary asylum seeker. That's it. I'm not complicit in any illegal activity. I am not an active spook. I am not on mission. I am not going to communicate with any other spooks. So, what for?
He appealed the decision, but after 15 months of life in a tiny flat, separated from his family in London, his health declining, and still no decision on the appeal he lodged in January, Boris has given up. He's bought a plane ticket back to the UK.
I hoped I would find refuge here. And even after I started to feel unsafe, I still continued and maintained to keep low profile. But when hope died, nothing left. So in my case, hope is already dead.
Surely while you're still here in New Zealand, there is still hope.
Not anymore, not anymore.
Boris Karpichkov fears what lies ahead. He could be arrested when he touches down in London. He has no resident status there either. A man with no home, no address, a citizen of nowhere. Last week, he left New Zealand the same way he arrived, undetected, using a forged Lithuanian passport he bought from a Russian crook for £2,200.
If you'd been allowed to stay, what would you have contributed?
We are talking about contribution. I already contributed to this society, excuse me. At least I helped unwillingly your local security services improve their skills. It's already, contribution has been done.
Hmm. We asked the police whether they were watching Karpichkov. Inspector Bruce Good insisted they weren't, and nor was any other agency that he was aware of. So what about getting into New Zealand on a forged passport? Well, the Department of Labour tells us, for reasons which can't be disclosed, he was not liable for prosecution for doing this, but the department is investigating how he was able to use a false passport to leave New Zealand. And finally today, an indication from the SIS that they probably were keeping an eye on him, but they refused to confirm that to us.